when she's like brushing the hair behind his ears, he's like, yeah. And she's like, you are in charge. Where would I be without you? And he's like, nowhere. Wait, hold on. He has a couple moments, almost wakes up from realizing that he's under her spell. And then yeah.
Cute, them kind of plotting their whole like, oh, well, maybe I can say I delivered a telegram by mistake and then I can come see you, because they need all these reasons to visit. When she sees him later and she's like, wouldn't you like to come by and like send a telegram? And he's all like, no, I love war and bad people. Lillian, hi, how are you?
I'm good. It's finally fall here, and I think we both dressed for it today.
Yes. I've got my plaid and flannel. Are you all sweatered?
I'm sweater weathering.
Cute. Sweater weather. It's awesome. Yay. Well, this is great. I love that we both broke our viewing of today's topic into multiple sections.
She is a long boy.
She's a very long boy. We're talking, of course, about The Sound of Music, The Longest Boy, but a beloved classic, great romance, and rather similar elements to our very beloved Jane Eyre. So, I guess maybe before we do initial thoughts, maybe you should give us a recap in case no one has seen this.
Because we know how often people come to us for the 1 to 17 minute recaps.
Right.
Of great classic films.
So Lillian, and just as a reminder, viewers, she had seen this as a kid and now has just come back to it. So let's see what stuck with you. I'm ready when you are.
All right. So we start with a woman in some hills, and we see a lot of those hills, and she is happy in these hills. She's running around The Sound of Music. She's a singer. And then we see her run back to a convent. That's what it's called. Convent. Mm-hmm. We're confident. It turns out all these ladies are talking about her behind her back because she's late one time. Calm down, guys. And then they're like, you know what? I think maybe you should see the world before you promise your eternal life to God because you like songs. So she goes off and becomes a governess, totally different from anything we've ever seen, to a very crabby man. Again, real different from anything we've ever seen before. And he has a billion children who are dressed in like little sailor uniforms, which I'd forgotten about. And he like leaves because he has a business trip. He has made it clear that discipline is what the children need. Mm-hmm. And she almost immediately after he leaves goes, actually, they don't need that. Takes them clothes out of curtains and just starts hanging out. And they just are having the best of times. They learn to sing. She finds the joy again. And then when he comes back, he's real mad when they fall out of a boat. But he's like, you know what? The singing is beautiful. Please stay. Then we meet his Blanching Groom. I'm so sorry. I mean, Baronet. She is like relatively nice, if I'm totally honest. But she notices that Maria and the captain have some chemistry. And when Jane and Rochester dance one night, Maria and the captain.
Wow.
She tells him, or the Blanche lady tells Jane lady, oh, good God,
oh my God, they're Lillian. In love.
And then she goes back to the convent, and then she comes back to this place and they do kissing, and the Blanche leaves. And then the Nazis go, you have to come work for us. And they're like, no, we're going to run away. And the nuns are going to help us. And then they climb through the mountains.
Wow. Okay. 2 minutes and 3 seconds.
It's a 3-hour movie.
Well, I love you. At the start, you're like, so she's in the hills and then she runs to the convent. And I'm thinking, are you going to describe every motion?
I lost track of like how much there is, and therefore how much like the level of detail I did at the beginning versus at the end was purely due to me being like, I don't want to listen to me do this anymore. Or listen to
Oh my God. So one story that I have to steal and share here on our podcast is something from one of my favorite podcasts, This American Life, which is also a nationwide radio program. They had on one of their episodes this like topic of, I think it was, you know, how you interpret something as a kid versus how you see it as an adult. adult. Mm-hmm. And so this woman was talking about how when she watched The Sound of Music as a little girl, they had it on these VHSs that were so big that they divided the movie into two parts. Mm-hmm. And she said that they must have lost the second one because she had only ever seen the first half of the movie before the intermission. And so she thought this was like the entire story. And her friend's like, so you've never seen the second half? You need to watch the rest of the movie. And she's like, when I was little, I always loved the romance between the eldest girl and her boyfriend. And she's like, he was like a mailman, wasn't he? And she's like, no, he wasn't a mailman. And they put it on, they're watching it. And she's like, oh no, he looks like a little Nazi. Because he was one. That was just so charming. So go check out This American Life, that episode. I can see if I can figure out which one it was. Just, I love that.
Yeah, my family also had it on VHS, although we had both nice. Tapes of it. Very but nice. I primarily watched it. My main viewing experience of this was we would watch it in parts when I was in elementary school when we had subs. Nice. So I probably watched this two or three times a year, every year when I was in elementary school. And I just got really over it. And while I was watching it, like the beginning, I was like, why wouldn't I love this? And then I got to certain parts and I was like, oh, I hated that. I have a visceral reaction to like the puppet scene.
Why do you hate the puppet scene? I think that's cool.
They're creepy and terrible, Piper.
Oh, no, they're so animated and they have so many different moving parts. It's impressive.
I always get lost. I got lost in logistics of how those puppets worked. There's just no way.
I actually think it's kind of clever, like editing, because they show the children like doing the puppetry for that. Mm-hmm. And it definitely wasn't, because in the opening credits, it says puppeteers and it lists these professional people.
That was that's professional puppeteers. Those kids couldn't have learned that in the 5 minutes after Uncle Max bought them.
The thing, yeah, that I didn't remember, that he apparently just brought them this. And they're just like, we're instantly great at doing this show. Also, we have this whole plot and music like planned out, but
the
sure,
kids
whatever.
Had never singed before in their life. They didn't even know how to do it. They didn't know how to sing.
Okay.
And then all of a sudden they sing Do Re Mi one time and they're the Van Trapp family singer.
Yep, it just happens perfectly. Well, I guess they inherited their father's singing voice, who I love. Everyone else is also surprised that he can do so, but yes.
Let's talk about this in order of a scotch. Or just crazy ramblings per always. I have so many facts about this movie.
Dude.
Let's talk about initial thoughts, because we did a little roasty,
yes.
A little toasty. Piper, uh-huh. What are your feelings about The Sound of Music?
I like it a whole lot. I think it's beautiful. That's one thing that I couldn't stop fixating on is, so they film in Salzburg, and mm-hmm. a lot of the on-location stuff is just absolutely breathtaking. These buildings, the mountains all around, all of these like statues and everything when they're going through the town. It's so pretty. So I was obsessed with the visuals, but I love the love story. I just really like it. I think it's kind of got that Beauty and the Beast thing, you know, where he's like really grumpy at first and then obviously mm-hmm. he opens up his heart and he's really sweet. And so I'm a big sucker for that. I personally think that Christopher Plummer is very handsome in that movie. And I, you know, who doesn't love Julie Andrews? So
I mean this with so much sincerity. Anybody who doesn't love Julie Andrews, please never listen to our podcast again.
There's the door. Lillian has just opened it for you.
Get out of here. Unless she did something terrible I don't know about, but I don't think so because I read her entire Wikipedia.
Oh my gosh. No, I absolutely adore this movie. I think it's great. So big fan.
I also loved this movie. I was genuinely a little bit like, I bet it's 3 hours going to drag on. No wonder I didn't like it when I was a kid. And 3 hours is a lot for a child, but you are actually an adult now. So you can watch things for a long period of time. I also was noticing the scenery and how beautiful it was. And mm-hmm. I'm so sorry to our listeners, but a really pretentious moment is about to come up. So if that's upsetting to you, please move on. I've been to Salzburg. Flips hair. I went when I was in high school. I went on a trip to Germany with my class, and we did. I had like fully forgotten until I was watching this, and I was like, I think I've been there. We went to like Sound of Music locations. Like we went and saw the gazebo and stuff, which If you think you're going to go dance in that gazebo, I have some real sad news for you. It's very small. They danced on a sound set. That was just the gazebo that was like in the background is the one you can go see in Austria.
Yeah.
But we saw like the garden that they run through when they sing Do Re Mi.
Pretty.
I went to that garden.
Dude, that's so awesome. I am jealous, but it's okay. Yeah, I'm very jealous.
And it's not okay. And that's
fine. Oh my God.
The actual thoughts that I had about the actual movie was... First of all, like my main thought for the first like 10 minutes was, oh my God, Julie Andrews is a spectacular actress. She's so good at singing. She's so good at all this stuff. So she had just won the Oscar for Mary Poppins as the main actress, which was right before this. And she did not win the Oscar for this. She was nominated, but she did not win again. And I'm mad about it. I looked up the other winner, didn't even know what it was.
I remember hearing, I think I was watching some kind of anniversary that they were doing for Sound of Music, and they were interviewing all the cast and everything. And I remember she said in the interview that while on the set of this movie, like, I don't think Mary Poppins had come out yet. And so she was teaching the kids how to sing Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious as well.
That's so cute.
Yeah, she's actually a real life teacher of songs with kids.
She's just so sweet. And I'm going to just do my facts about Julie Andrews now because I love her and I want to gush about her. For the first time she was in like musical theater was when she was 10 years old. So she has a really interesting history actually with, she was in the UK during World War II. So she has an interesting history with like how, anyway, there's this whole thing there. she has two biographies. You should read them both. I'm going to, I've added them to my list. Her mom and her stepdad were really into theater. So the first time she was on stage was in a production that her parents put on when she was 10 years old in 1945. She then was, when she was 13, where she was the youngest solo artist to perform for the king, who was King George the Sixth, and the future Queen Elizabeth was there as well. And then she won the award, the Oscar in 64. Nothing happened in between there. No, lots of things happened in between there. Her awards are endless. So I'm going to do the fastest version of it I can do is this list contains Oscars, BAFTAs, Golden Globes, Grammys, Tonys, Screen Actor Guild Awards, Drama Desk Awards, and then a few Lifetime Achievement Awards that she's won.
Very cool.
And out of those, she has been nominated 135 times.
Wow.
And has won 67. Impressive. She's been nominated for 3 Tonys, but has never won a Tony and therefore doesn't have her EGOT. That's the only one she needs for an EGOT. And I think they should give her a Lifetime Achievement Award anyway.
If I'm not mistaken, so she originally was, what's the character's name? She was in My Fair Lady on Broadway. And then when they did that as a movie, they swapped her out with Audrey Hepburn. And it was this whole thing about like Audrey couldn't sing and she took all these singing lessons. And then they just dubbed her anyway. And everyone's like, what the hell? Just use Julie Andrews. And it was a whole deal. But yeah.
Yeah. So I did read about that. And at the time, Audrey Hepburn was like a big name and they thought they needed a big name to bring people in. That movie came out, My Fair Lady with Audrey Hepburn came out the same year that Mary Poppins came out, and she won the Oscar up against Audrey Hepburn for the Very role nice. She'd been replaced in. That's which is awesome. Just like, sometimes instant karma is very good.
Love it.
But basically, I have always loved Julie Andrews. I loved Mary Poppins. When I was a kid, I've probably seen Mary Poppins more than any other movie, just because of the sheer number of times I watched it as a child.
Cute. It's so funny because I feel like I just rewatched The Princess Diaries, and that was kind of my intro to Mary Poppins. I mean, Mary Poppins, Julie Andrews, one in the same.
She is Mary Poppins.
I mean, obviously, I grew up with Mary Poppins, but I think of her most of what like struck me in my childhood with her was her being the grandma in Princess Diaries.
Yeah. The queen. She's a grandma. As a teen, I kept my head on a swivel for Julie Andrews coming to tell me that I'm a princess.
Wouldn't it be great?
Yeah.
Although our good friend Shannon has actually met Julie Andrews because she came and spoke at her art school that she attended. Oh, so yeah, lucky lady.
That's amazing.
It's almost as if we've met her, Lillian, because a friend of ours. Yeah. So,
which is how I treat all of life. I think the thing that struck me, I knew she was an amazing singer. I knew she was like an actress. actress, obviously knew she was an actress. Her comedic timing, particularly in the first 20 minutes, I forgot. I don't think as a kid you can appreciate how funny this movie is.
Yes.
Until like they're singing that song, the How to Solve a Problem Like Maria, and she comes running in and she runs past them a little bit and then like stops and like takes a couple of steps back and like realizes she's caught and sort of does this, okay, whatever. Like it's too late now. And it's so funny.
No, I love it. I often, like, when I remember watching this as a little kid, all the nun stuff felt like it took five ever. And so I typically just, like, zoned out when those scenes were happening. So I was like, I don't care about this. Where's all the kids and all the fun stuff? Yeah, it's so interesting. Her, I don't know, journey from, I want to sort of, as we go through this, draw as many Jane Eyre comparisons as we can.
Oh, yeah. Right?
Her nunnery is Lowood School. I would say much better than Lowood by many miles. But this idea too, that when she's talking to the Mother Superior about being like, oh, I can be better. Like I want to, you know, devote myself to this, that she's like, well, like when you were a little girl and you were looking over the wall at us, you know, and like telling that story, what I see in Maria that Jane has is this like want to be part of a family and want to be like accepted and with people who love her and are kind to her. And so I think she seeks that first with the order, the sisters, and then later, of course, finds her family with the Von Trapps. But
yeah, and I felt like the parallel that I see there as well is I was looking at it and I was like, it's basically what I think Lowood could be if the women were in charge instead of Broccoli. Because the Mother Superior or whatever her name is in this was very much a Miss Temple figure in my mind. And I think that that like guidance that she gave our Maria Jane, in some ways it's Jane if her fire wasn't tempered a bit, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
She has a similar strength to Jane, but there's a few moments where I'm like, oh, Jane would not be that forward.
Yes. Oh my God. That's one thing I absolutely love about Maria is from the moment she steps in the house and he's there. And like, I love, she like walks into that ballroom, which clearly has been sealed up. It's the Beast's West Wing. And he's like, no, we don't have fun in this house. And that ballroom is for fun. So keep it closed. But I love right away. She's like, kind of like not taking any guff from him. He's like, these are rules. And she's like, I'm sorry, but I can't do that. And it's just great.
Well, and the whistle thing where he does the whistle for all his kids have their own special calls. And he goes, and this is your call. So when I blow this signal, you have to come to me for this thing. And she's like, no, that's so disrespectful. And then he's like, you're going to learn how to use this whistle. And like, she's like very clearly resisting him. And he's very clearly like, just not having her resistance. Like he's not even like really acknowledging it. Mm-hmm. And she, when she blows the whistle and goes, sir, you never gave me your signal.
It's so good. Like, ooh, boy.
So good.
I know that when they're in the gazebo at the end and he says that he fell in love with her when she first sat on that pine cone, which cute and funny. I think he fell in love with her from day one moment when like she's talking back. How can you not?
Well, I think the reason that I like it as the pine cone thing, because I think he's intrigued by her immediately, but he's a little bit annoyed. Mm-hmm. But I think when she sits on the pine cone and she doesn't rat out his kids.
Yes.
Yeah. I think he's like, because he doesn't know, it's so clear that he doesn't know what to do with a bunch of kids. Mm-hmm. The only thing that he knows how to do is like, the only thing he's good at is running a military tight ship. And he's used to taking probably 18 year old kids who've joined the army and don't know what they're doing and giving them discipline. And then they thrive. Like that's what he's thinking of. Gretel is five. Doesn't work. So I think that's a really beautiful moment of like when she tells them like this story, the way she like doesn't let them get away with anything, but also doesn't rat them out to their dad and doesn't kind of cave, isn't really punishing them. She's just telling them, hey, I was obviously really nervous to be here and you greeted me with a frog in my pocket. And the acting of those children crying,
Beautiful. Yes. The fact that she like does her Catholic best and guilts them into being like, oh, don't worry, but just so you know, blah, 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 all this stuff. And they all start crying. And she's like, oh, yeah, it's cool. They're fine. What does she say to him? She's like, oh, they're just so happy.
They're just so happy. He's like, is this going to be an every night, every meal or just dinner sort of situation? Yeah. And like the fact that that's the moment for me that's like so fun is like, that for me, the reason I like that being the moment that he falls in love with her is he's bantering back. Like before she's having fun, sort of almost at his expense, like finds his intensity endearing and funny. Mm-hmm. And so she like sees this man who does not know what he's doing with these sweet kids.
Is
like, oh, you goober, you, you just, one of our listeners this week on Twitter said about Toby's Stevens and his performance as Rochester, that she goes, it's not so much an I can change you or I can save you, my love could save you situation, as much as it's he is begging to be saved. That's how I feel about the captain as well, is like he is begging to be saved by Joy, and that's what she brings in.
I am so curious to know more about like his first wife, which is, it's good that, you know, they just focus on this romance. But I mean, I think the fact that they have so many children, clearly they were very in love. But, and clearly too, that their house used to be such a happy place where I assume that he would sing like with them and stuff like this before. But then now that Joy is gone when she left. But it's nice that what you say of, you know, asking to be saved, he's clearly ready to love again. I mean, we know this from him courting the Baroness. And I think it's just like him sort of being like, I should have a person in my life once more. I should open myself up to love again. Turns out Baroness is not the one who will do that for him, but instead a convent girl. but so it's sweet. But should we talk about the Baroness and Max real quick?
Absolutely. I want to, one little note on that, because I agree with you. I think it's very sweet. But I think in addition to like, I need to move on with my life, like he's gotten past that like raw grief where everything was so out of control and he brought in this control that way that he had it before. I also think there's an element of he knows he's failing his kids. Like he knows that what he's doing isn't working and he has no idea how else to do it. And so I get the impression from his relationship with the Baronet that it's not as much about him wanting to be in love again, because he thinks she's fine. Like he thinks she's pretty. I think it's more about him wanting a mother for his kids. And then when he sees Maria filling that role so well, that kind of opens his heart up in this whole new way, in a way that he didn't even think, like he didn't even know what he really wanted in a mother for his kids until he sees it.
So cute. I love it.
Okay. But the Baronet and Max.
By the way, you keep saying Baronet. Isn't it Baroness? She's like, she married a baron, he died, and now she's the Baroness.
I think you're right, but let me check. You tell us about that while I do a Goog.
Sounds good. I loved that you said in your summary that she is like Blanche, but what if Blanche was cool? Because I agree. I've never seen her as a villain. I think it's incredibly awesome of her to, you know, see that Maria is kind of like starting to like take the man that she wants to be with away from her. And she is very mature about how she handles that. She goes up to speak with Maria. I think you could argue that like she's maybe being somewhat like deceitful of like convincing Maria to leave, but I don't think that's really the case. I see it as more, she goes up to her and she's like, hey, I can see that there's a thing here. And she just simply draws that out into the public. And then Maria is the one who's like, oh, well, I should go because this is irresponsible of me. Like I'm his employee, you're his betrothed, essentially. I should get out of the way. And I think that's an incredible scene because, I don't know, I hate it in movies and shows when someone doesn't just come out and say what they're thinking. So I love that she addresses it.
I think I agree with you. I think that totally makes a lot of sense. I think she's a beautifully complex character in a way that often women in that role of like, I'm the like perfect lady for society, like the very Blanche-like character, right? Like I'm the perfect lady of society. And therefore I'm going to be kind of mean. And I'm really just the barrier that's preventing these two people who are clearly in love from being together. Mm-hmm. And I'm totally oblivious, but also just like selfishly pursuing this man. Mm-hmm. I love that she's rich.
Yeah.
And I love that she truly wants him. Like, she's not trying to trick him for power. And she knows that he comes with 7 kids and she likes them and she thinks they're charming. I don't think she wants to be a mom in the way that Maria wants to be a mom to these mm-hmm. kids, but I do think she sincerely loves him. And I agree with you. I think that moment is more than a selfish motivation to get her out of there.
Yeah.
I think she does a little bit think that men are what men are. And if there's a beautiful nanny there, mm-hmm. he's going to get feelings for her and they're not going to last also, but it might mess up her plan. Like, I think it's this dual, like selfless and selfish.
Yeah, totally.
Motivation to have that conversation. But I agree. I prefer it to be an explicit conversation versus like, they could have done a movie where she just like tries to manipulate this woman into leaving.
Yeah.
And I don't or, like that.
Right. Or like, you know, say some snide thing to try to make like mm-hmm. the captain not like Maria or something. But no, mm-hmm. she goes up, she talks to her, she says, hey, you're gorgeous. He clearly likes you. I am in love with this guy. And Maria's like, wow, I'm so sorry. I'll get out of the way. Like I love that is a scene that happens. Yeah. The fact that she's not after his money or anything. I think that she does truly care for him. The one part that you could possibly like see her as like a villain is when she's talking to Max and she says, that's what like boarding school is for or whatever. Like she plans to kind of like ship off the kids because she's not very good with them. We see that in the scene where after Maria is gone and the Baroness is trying to play this game with the kids, but she just sucks at it because she's like, I am really not one for play. Like I like to, you know, be in my fancy salons in whatever Austrian city she's from. But
well, I'm like, well, really rich people, I think still, my assumption is still, but definitely in the past, did a lot of like the mom's job was as much organizing what schools the kids went to and getting them into the good ones and all that stuff as it was being hands-on. And like, I feel like she wants to be a rich mom. She wants to have the kids come home for holidays and be there to open presents mm-hmm. and be there when they want to show off to their friends, but they go get a good education somewhere else. She's not talking about like abandoning them or sending them to some terrible, she's not sending them to Lowood school. She's not Aunt Reed. Like that's right. not what's happening. But I think she's a wonderfully simple or a sympathetic character mm-hmm. and has that complexity that in characters who play the role she does, we often don't see.
Yeah. Fabulous character in the Baroness. We love her. 10 out of 10.
Which you're right. It is Baroness. Cool. Baronet is like a different, my brain was like, I know a Baronet is a thing and therefore it must be the wife of a baron. And it's not. It's a different level of royalty situation. Oh, so cool. You can spend a lot of time Googling that if you want to.
All right. So now we have Max. So the three of them together are this cute little trio of friends. And Max is totally a gay man, right?
Oh, for sure. He's very queer coded. I mean, he's not like out and gay in 1965, but yeah.
I would, if we're going to, you know, hypothesize about character backstory, probably he spends a lot of time in the very progressive city of Berlin, which was like a gay hub for like gay culture and queer culture and all kinds of great stuff
right up
before
until
the Nazis
got,
came in and changed everything.
Well, and murdered them.
I love that. That's I think something that is sort of, I feel, a nod to people who mm-hmm. like, you watch this and you're like, oh, sweet. That's kind of representation. Yay. Glad he's here.
The most representation you're getting in a movie in 1965.
Yeah. But he essentially, it seems, is like a talent scout and he always looking for like a new act that's going to like get him rich. Well, I love when they're driving in the car and he first hears the monks singing and he's like, maybe I can represent them. He's just like right away. He's like, who can I find who can get me some money?
Well, and I kind of like how he's really forward with his selfish motivations. Like he talks about the fact that we have to keep the family together to keep my money together.
Yes.
It's like a running joke that he has, but he clearly sincerely cares about these people, but he's not going to hide the fact that it is convenient for him that other people make him rich and mm-hmm. that he wants to be rich and famous.
All the stuff in between these moments when these groups come together, we mentioned in your summary, Maria teaches them how to sing. She helps them have fun and loosen up. They admit that they are problematic because it's the only way to get their father's attention. And I love that that is when the captain and his girlfriend and their friend Max arrive. And, you know, he's so upset about them having been climbing trees. And I think for him, he's like, oh, this is embarrassing. Like, people will know my children. They know that they're mine. And maybe they'll think that I'm not taking care of them or they're not being respectable. So I think that's why he's upset, not just because they have been singing and things. But it's that standoff that he has with Maria, where she like yells at him and says, no, they just want to be loved. You don't spend time with your children. You're wrong. They need love, not discipline. And she lists all these things about them where she's like, your daughter is going to be a woman soon and your son just wants, you know, to be a man and have you respect him and all of that stuff. And it's that fight where she's like, all right, I guess I'm leaving. And then he's like, no, please don't leave, because they have a beautiful singing moment. And he's like, you've brought joy to this house. Essentially, I love you. Please stay.
I totally love that. Like, I loved that scene so much. I loved the fact that he kept trying to just dismiss it and walk away. He is very avoidant of those things, like Mr. Rochester. She won't let him look away from this. And she like yells at him right back. I also loved the way that the apologies happened when they kind of reconciled and they had this moment where he said, I'm so sorry first. And then she acknowledged that she was being a bit much. Because like, I think often in those situations, particularly when it's a woman who's sort of standing her ground, the idea of like the tone, it's that tone policing thing of like, the way you said this was bad and therefore I don't actually have to listen to you. Mm-hmm. But the fact that he apologized first and then she went, you know what? I contributed to it. Like, sure, what you did was pretty intense, but I definitely contributed to that situation and like could have been calmer and could have been better in the way I presented that to you. Yeah. And I was like, great. I love that they're both taking responsibility for the conflict, but that he acknowledges that like, ultimately it's his fault. Firing her was wild.
I think one of the reasons why I love this movie so much is I think it's a more equal representation of like they're shown as equals. Mm-hmm. And that's in a movie that came out like what, in the 60s?
65, yeah.
Yeah. And that's something that sometimes isn't even present in romances today. Mm-hmm. Where there's like this weird thing. But yeah, he like, I think it's best in the first time when he's meeting with her, I believe, is when, or is it this time? He calls her captain at one point, which he yells captain at her. And he's like, no, wait, hang on. Because that's a beautiful slip. Yes, because it's like, he's like, in his mind, clearly he's like, you are right up there with me. And I see your authority. I recognize that. And so, yeah, I just think there's beautiful equality throughout this. And the way that he like apologizes and is kind to her and vice versa is just beautiful.
Mm-hmm. I think that's another, like that theme is one of the themes that makes Jane Eyre so timeless, is this idea of love comes between two people that are equal and care about each other and see each other at the same level, even if society doesn't necessarily see them at that same level, where Jane Eyre is much more explicit in that. I think The Sound of Music is more implicit in that. And it's more these subtext moments. And the fact that when they talk to each other, every moment after that, they consider each other equals. And like when they solve problems, they solve them together and all that stuff. So
yeah,
very, very cute. Do we want to talk about some of the songs specifically? Because I specifically want to talk about the Child Bride song.
Child Bride song. Oh, you mean I am 16 going on 17?
Yes.
Sure.
First of all, that was one of the songs that like, I always thought was like so romantic. And it's like, oh, this was like what my little teen brain, or like, honestly, elementary school brain was like, I'm going to find an older guy who's going to tell me what to do. And he's going to help me sort it through. And he's going to be like, you're so special. And I should be in charge of you. And then I became a very angry teen and went, that was actually really messed up. And that sort of sucked. And so as an adult, literally, as soon as the first thing that he says of like, you wait, little girl, I'm like, I literally out loud went, gross. And then,
At
sorry.
least there, I mean, he's literally a year older than her. It would be, I think,
Totally.
I would read it way creepier if he was actually an adult,
Yes.
but they're just like a couple of teens.
Which SNL did a really funny skit with John Mulaney
I've
playing
seen
into
that.
that. We'll put that on Twitter at least.
So good.
The funny thing in watching it as an adult is like, I was all ready for it to be all those things that I used to think were super romantic when I was a kid. And then I watched them. And I'm like, that's actually a child, and you should probably stop. Instead, I did see something really different in watching it. And it's that he's not in charge of that even a little bit at all. She is 100% in control of every beat of their relationship. And I love it.
Yeah, because I think that's what's so great is that we sing this entire song, right? Of him being like, I'll take care of you. And she's like, yeah, you will. She is absolutely the puppet master here. And at the very end, yeah, like she's the one who, is like, do it, kiss me, kiss me. And then he does, but he like runs off. And she's like, yeah, I spun my web and I got my fly.
Well, and it's that moment when she's standing on the bench before they do the run around, and she's like just kind of like stroking his cheeks, and she's the one who like gave him a hug when they ran up, scandalous. And he's like, no, we like can't do that. We can't be that like touchy feely. It's not right because whatever reasons, society and properness. And she's the one who's like, when she's like brushing the hair behind his ears, he looks like a puppy who's about to like do. He's like, yeah. And she's like, you are in charge. What, where would I be without you? And he's like, nowhere. I'm in charge of, wait, hold on. He has a couple moments where he like almost wakes up from realizing that he's under her spell, and then they do the little kiss at the end, and it's so much cuter. And then he turns out to be a Nazi, and so that's not so great. You know,
Before
teenage
that,
girls make mistakes.
yeah.
Teenage boys become Nazis.
Before that, though, it is really cute them kind of plotting their whole like, oh, well, maybe I can say I delivered a telegram by mistake and then I can come see you because they need all these reasons to visit. Because he makes that turn, it makes the heartbreak so much worse when she sees him later and she's like, wouldn't you like to come by and like send a telegram? And he's all like, no, I love war and bad people. And she's like, oh shit, you. So.
Nationalism got me. Which, by the way, I know usually I bring bummer history facts. I do have some history facts, but they're not about the Nazis. The
Yay.
Nazis are very bad. Go
Duh.
Google that yourself if this is news to you. I know we've said it on the last episode, but we're very against Nazis on this podcast.
Wow. I don't think we even need to say that out loud, but
I
yeah.
know. Okay. He's like such a little ding dong. And she's great. And I love the moment between her and Maria, where she does the like calling her mother, and she's like, oh, mother, I like calling you that. And then Maria says to her, like, this is what love is, and this is what love should feel like. And yeah, it is kind of scary. And yeah, you don't really know. And yes, I'm actually really new to this, and it made me really nervous. But you're 16, you have plenty of time to fall in love. Don't get too wrapped up in the little Nazi boy that doesn't like you anymore. And she's just like, I won't get wrapped up in little Nazi boy, especially after he tried to shoot my dad.
And then ratted on our family and made us had to run away.
But the nuns who are so badass
I know.
took parts of the car engine.
So good. I feel like the biggest, best romantic part for me is two parts. One, I adore the ball scene, the
Yes,
whole thing,
yes, yes.
when he steps in and starts dancing with Maria, the captain. I love that moment. That video is in my romantic videos playlists, just
Cute.
called Love, that I throw on whenever I feel like watching sappy stuff. But I love how, at first he comes in and it's like this nice little thing, them dancing, but there's a very obvious shift that happens, and it's when he turns around and she does the like the hand over the shoulder thing, and then he guides her, and then they start to get into that kind of when their arms are up and they're standing real close to one another. It goes from fun to suddenly super romantic, and everyone can tell. The Baroness is watching, the kids are watching. I love the kid. One daughter is even like, she's like, your face is all red. And she's like, oh, is it? Like, 'cause she's like super blushing because she's like
I'm
super
not
in love
used
with her
to dance
boss.
like the little like face, like constantly touching your face because you're like, I'm just not used to dancing.
It's so dang cute. So I adore that moment so much because, like, the way that he looks at her, oh my God. But then when they finally share their love, their feelings for one another in the gazebo. Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful moment. I love when he comes to her. He just his whole aura and the way that he talks, you can see that he's like already decided. He's like, you're the one for me. I'm going to tell you we're going to be together forever. And it's like the same kind of vibes from the guy from North and South has on the train station, I think. Yeah, where it's like, this is a man who is so in love. And whatever you say, it doesn't matter. He's just going to be like, I just love you so much. And I just have to tell you that.
It's the like moment of, oh, actually everything else that I was so worried about matters so much less than loving you and being able to let go. Like in the same way of letting go of the Baroness is letting go of the mill and all that stuff. And just being like, oh my God, I love you. And that can be the most important thing to me.
Yeah.
Like there's this interesting, I think, I don't want to talk too much about gender roles, but like, I think there's this interesting idea that often in my favorite romances, men are in positions where they're like, oh my God, love and this woman can be the center of my world if I wanted to. Like, that's an acceptable way to choose to live my life. Yeah. And women often have the opposite journey of like, oh my God, I don't have to find a man. And I can, but I can. And he's going to help support me and my dreams. Mm-hmm. And that's what I really wanted. And like, that's just so beautiful. What a cutie. And the song too, first of all, two incredible actors, like two of the greatest actors of all times, singing this beautiful song gives me chills every time I listen to it.
Yeah.
Something Good. Are you kidding me?
I know. Oh my God. It's just so beautiful. I also personally am in love with the way that he kisses her, where like face touching and grabbing can be very tricky. Like sometimes it can seem like too forceful or whatever, but just the way that he like kind of cups her chin and like pulls her close to him to give that kiss. It's so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And then like they kind of pull apart and then he like kisses her forehead and is like, oh my God, I love it so much.
Absolutely. It's so good. And then I did have a little bit of a moment where I do think they need just a scotch of kissing lessons when they're just rubbing their faces together afterwards.
Oh, well, that's a classic like old cinema thing.
Classic old cinema and also classic musical because they have to sing. Mm-hmm. So it's like they can't actively be kissing. But I also think obviously one of the things that I noted watching this, because I hadn't thought about how old this movie is. Mm-hmm. This movie is only 22 years after the Orson Welles, whatever it's called.
Jane Eyre.
Yeah, Orson Welles, Jane Eyre. I didn't know Jane Eyre. I was looking.
Amazing. What's our podcast about again? Just beautiful, Lillian. Just beautiful.
I was looking for Joanna, whatever her name is.
Oh.
Or Joan or something. So sorry to that beautiful actress who did an amazing job of playing Jane. And sorry to Piper for thinking your co-host is so dumb. I didn't know the words Jane Eyre.
Amazing. Sorry.
Oh my God. Anyway, it's 23 years after that. And I forget how much, like, even just a kiss, like, I think those hugs were kind of supposed to be kisses, right? Like, mm-hmm. that the teens had.
Yeah.
But, like, there's something even more, like, romantic when you compare the way that, like, they do a physical affection in movies now. Mm-hmm. It doesn't build nearly as much tension. Yeah. Like, they'll have tension and then, like, they're going to have sex, like, immediately. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that's not to say that's not how things might happen for some people, mm-hmm. but the tension into a kiss and the kiss in and of itself being the like peak of romance.
Yes.
I think that's sweet.
I agree. It's so nice. Cause then it happens and you're like, oh, wedding bells, happily ever afters. And we've been waiting the whole movie for this moment.
I did also love that it did go from Something Good immediately into Wedding Bells. And they didn't like pretend they were going to date for a bit. And maybe there was a time jump, right? Like obviously you don't get a dress that gorgeous overnight. Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's really the only thing I want to talk about for the wedding is her dress.
Yeah, I have to say this is not a fresh take. Many people have said this before, but I'm sorry. My nun's friends are not allowed to sing "What Do You Do with a Problem Like Maria" when I'm walking down the aisle. I'd be like, "Listen up, you bitches. Like, shut up. I did it. I'm happy. This is my day. I am the bride. You're not allowed to sing about how I'm a problem."
Okay, can I play it at your bachelorette party?
Yes. But I want a sick remix version so that we can really like jam to it. Yeah.
I'm gonna find a moment when you're not expecting it at your bachelorette party, and I'm gonna play it, and everyone else there is gonna be like, "What are you doing?" And I'm gonna be like, "Piper will know."
Amazing.
No, for sure. That don't do that to me. Don't
Yeah.
sing a song about how I'm a problem at
Yeah.
my wedding.
You're like, "Ooh, Lillian, she's so fine. She's so fine. She blows our mind. Hey, Lillian."
I know
That's
I'm
what
a
we'll sing.
problem. The person I'm marrying knows I'm a problem. Please don't do that to me.
Yeah, seriously, I want to see she gets up to the front there and like the captain leans over and he's like, "What the fuck was that all about?"
It's
Like,
kind of
don't
like
ask. It's
my
an inside
theme
joke.
song here. They're honestly, why do you think I'm leaving? They're kind of bitchy.
I love that they're like, "All right, so we gotta get off on this honeymoon. Definitely gotta go make love to my beautiful, beautiful bride." So yay, that's something they get that our poor Rochester and Jane never do. So good for them. No interruptions happened in this wedding. How crazy.
I know, it was wild. Although the Nazis did immediately interrupt their life, whoopsie,
Yes.
and their happy ending, which I
Yes.
think that was what Allison had said when she goes, "The Nazis are Bertha." And I was like, that's hilarious. Watching this, guys, the Nazis are Bertha.
Yeah.
They keep alluding to at random moments, there's these hints of conflict and hints
Yep.
of something, and it's the Nazis.
Yeah.
Which this is the only history fact on that. And then I have some fun facts about the real life family. But so Austria was not taken over by the Nazis through force. It was through politics. And they had, there's a German word for it that I can't remember. But they basically like annexed Austria. So that's what, like, I didn't know any of that history when I watched as a child. I honestly, all I knew about the Nazis when I was in like first grade was bad guys, don't like
Yes.
them. Being a
Yes.
Nazi is a bad thing. So watching it now, I had a little bit more of like, oh, okay,
Yeah.
I see now.
It is interesting to see how it sort of kind of crept in. And yeah, not to get into politics or whatever, of course, but like at the party when everyone's having fun and this guy's like, "Where's that Nazi flag? Like, why are you displaying the Austrian flag?" And it's like, dude, we're at a fucking party. Can you leave your politics at the door? But also, very important to talk about these things so that they don't sneak up on you like this. Whatever.
Yeah, and I think it was it's an interestingly relevant point that the conflict between Max the captain, because so often there's this idea of like, it doesn't affect me, I'm just not gonna do anything. It's best to just keep your head down and make sure Max has a line at one point where he says, whatever's gonna happen is gonna happen. Just make sure it doesn't happen to you. And the
And the
captain
captain
is very
freaks
not
out.
that way.
Yeah. I feel like those moments are probably when you love him the best, right? When he's being like,
Absolutely.
yeah, him ripping that Nazi flag probably got your heart all a flutter.
Listen, there was a few moments where he got my heart all aflutter. Have you heard that? Have you heard that? There's a sound that was famous on TikTok. I don't know if it's made it to Reels yet, but it's basically like the sound of someone being like, so you have some sort of moment of an actor being particularly sexy, and you just go, "Daddy, sorry, daddy, sorry, daddy,
Yes.
sorry."
Yes.
That was the mo I had, when he opens the very first moment we see him, when he opens the ballroom doors and he's like kind of backlit and has it like coming up from under his face and she's a little startled by him. I very much went, "Daddy, sorry, daddy,
Yes.
sorry,
No.
Captain." Ooh.
He is a daddy. It's so true.
Okay. I want to talk about the dress and I want to look at the dress while we talk about it. So listeners, obviously
You're
go to
talking
our
about her
Instagram.
wedding dress?
Her wedding dress,
Yeah.
the
Yeah.
dress.
Okay. The dress.
It's beautiful. I love it so much. It's so the thing that I kept trying to describe when I looked at it, because we talk a lot about how these wedding dresses are simultaneously of the time that they're supposed to be representing, which in this case is the 1930s, late 30s, because it was 1938 that this took place historically. And also now, right? Yeah. Like, or also the moment that it came out, so like movie the came out. Yeah. So it's like this simultaneously being 38 and 65. Mm-hmm. I think this wedding dress is timeless.
Agreed.
I think if you wore this to your wedding, which I know you already have a dress, and it is, Sam, an exact replica of the Sound of Music dress. But no, you would kill me if that's
No, but it's gorgeous. It's
so
like,
gorgeous.
Yeah, like the silk. I think the fabric is my favorite.
So beautiful. The way that it's like fitted to her. But I've never liked a dress with long sleeves, and the long sleeves on this work.
Mm-hmm.
I love her veil. Her veil is beautiful.
With a little kind of laurel crown.
Mm-hmm.
It's very nice.
Anyway, I just needed to talk about that specifically because I love this dress so much. And then the way they play with the light.
Mm-hmm. She's glowing.
Yeah. I think if I was that beautiful, maybe I wouldn't care that my friends were singing about what a problem I am.
Nah, she killed it.
And there's that super specific moment as she literally locks her old life away.
Yes.
Into her new life. How, speaking of things that are not the same as Jane Eyre, how many people were at this wedding?
A bazillion people.
A lot of people.
I feel like it's the kind of thing, since the captain is like, he has this kind of stature within their society. I'm sure it's sort of like all those people who are at the ball, they're all here. And everybody else within their kind of like social circles, maybe they're not friends and family, but they're like, oh, well, we have to be here. This important man is getting married. So.
Yeah. And I also think it does a really good job of highlighting exactly what he's giving up, because it's after this moment that we start seeing things changing and they have to leave, and he leaves everything behind.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of what they're giving up to stick with his morals.
I also love that there's not even a second of for hesitation for him when he like gets that telegram. He's like, all right, I guess we have to leave Austria. Like, that's just it. There's no like, oh no, our house, our stuff, my friends, all this stuff. It's like, nope, we are getting out of here. By the way, real quick, got to talk about how poor Baroness, I think she handled that so well when he's breaking up with her, and she's like, oh, you know what? No, it's fine. Like, I'm not sad. I'm not sad at all. Maybe I'll go globetrotting. Maybe I'll go find some other guy. Like, don't worry about me. Bye. And like gets out of there. And it's like, oh, poor lady. Like, she actually cared. I mean, she totally did.
Yeah. Yeah. But I also think like, I liked that they didn't draw it out. I liked that they didn't have a conflict. I liked that she just kind of went, you love her. I'm going to go.
Yeah.
I do have some facts about the family and the true stories about the family. I have a couple bonnet watch things. And then I had some other cast facts, but none of them are as interesting as my Julie Andrews ones.
My cast fact from the reunion thing that they did of bringing back the actors is the actress who played the eldest daughter. She apparently like had a huge crush on the guy who played Christopher Plummer, her dad. And so she's like, oh man, like I had a huge crush on him. And there was like the Edelweiss song when he's like singing to her. And she's like, I like could hardly remember what to do next, because I was just so in love with you.
There is this, like when you watch it, there is this like bizarre moment of like, what are you doing? Do we have anything else we need to talk about? Any others? Songs, any other plot points?
No, I mean, great movie. We love it. They climb that mountain, and she carries that kid in those heels. And I'm like, I'm so sorry that you have to climb in your little heels, but whatever.
Yeah, genuinely, my reaction to her wearing kitten heels while hiking through the mountains was like, my first reaction was, this family is not prepared to hike through the mountains. They're not doing this with joy. But my second reaction was, I think that maybe women should be in charge of the world, because we also hike through mountains, but we do it in heels.
Exactly. You've heard that classic line about Ginger Rogers, about how she should have like been more famous than Fred Astaire because she did everything he did, but she did it backwards and in heels.
Yes.
Yeah. No.
Yes. Yes, yes, yes. Oh my gosh. That's amazing. Well, so the actual family, I don't think it's going to be a surprise to anyone to know they made this a lot more dramatic for a movie than it was in life. In life, the man whose name is, the parents' names are the same. That was the thing I was forgetting. So his name is Gregor Von Trapp. So he had his wife died in 1922, And he wrote to the Abbey in 1926. So that's when Maria was sent to work for the family.
Okay.
They then got married a year later. So they got married in 1927. And it wasn't until 1938 that they left. So they were the Von Trapp family singers. Maria actually wrote a book called The Von Trapp Family Singers after her friend really encouraged her, because her friend thought it was this amazing story and wanted to make sure people remembered it.
Cute.
And it had been adapted into, I believe, a couple of German films. And then somebody did a dramatic, I want to say a dramatic movie. You'll have to double check on that one. And that's how Rodgers and Hammerstein, who wrote the musical, right?
It was Rodgers and Hammerstein.
Okay.
Yeah.
So that's how Rodgers and Hammerstein ended up finding the story, was from that dramatic movie about it. And that's when they produced it into this musical. So some of the choices that they made to make it more dramatic had been made by these other adaptations as well.
Okay.
But they did do two performances at that festival.
Mm-hmm.
And they did leave Germany, or did leave Austria, but they left right before everything shut down. So okay. They did not, my understanding, and I didn't spend hours studying this, so if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. They left on a train to Italy, and then they made it out and ended up in the US. Gotcha. So they were not climbing through mountains.
By the way, speaking of adapting this, do you happen to know if this was originally a stage play before it was a movie? Was it?
It was originally a musical on Broadway. Yes.
On Broadway. Okay.
1959. It was a cool. musical on Broadway. Julie Andrews, though, did not play Maria in that.
Mm-hmm.
It was sort of after the whole issue with the My Fair Lady thing.
Yeah.
And the buzz she was starting to generate that she was asked to do this, which another interesting thing. And I do think this was the actual Maria's actual age when she fell in love with the actual Captain Von Trapp.
Mm-hmm.
So she was 22 and he was 47,
huh.
which I think is honestly less creepy than 19 and 37.
Oh, totally. Yeah. Because she's at least a woman.
A for like real adult.
Yes.
The actors were, so Captain Von Trapp, who was played by name of actor, help me.
Christopher Piper. Plummer.
Christopher Plummer.
R.I.P.
He was 36 when this movie came out, and Julie Andrews was 30, which, yes. Listen, I'm almost 30. She looks amazing for 30.
She does. But Julie Andrews, I think, is also a pretty well-trained dancer. Mm-hmm. So she's got that small dancer body.
Yeah. If you want to read about someone who had an incredible life, read about Julie Andrews. Like I genuinely like started getting lost in her Wikipedia page during this. Yeah. There's really cool things. There's lots of Where Are They Now articles about the kids. It won a lot of Academy Awards. I think the total Academy Awards was 5. It was nominated for 10. Julie Andrews was robbed. I am going to write a handwritten letter to the Academy about the 1966 Academy Awards.
Oh my gosh. No, it's like, okay, shut up about the fact that you don't have enough people of color or women representation or gay people. What about the fact that Julie Andrews didn't get that award 25 years ago?
I've decided to set aside my values and my current day political ambitions and just get really mad about how little Julie Andrews have been recognized despite her many, many awards.
Amazing. Yes.
So the last fact I have about the show, and it's because I Googled this while we were talking. This is not confirmed, and it's not great to speculate about people's sexual orientation, but it is believed that Rodgers and Hammerstein were in love with each other.
Mm-hmm.
And so it makes sense that they had a queer-coded character in
Perfect.
Their musical.
Yay. Awesome.
Okay.
Huzzah. We did it. We talked about Sound of Music.
Yay. Okay. What is your rating?
I think I'm going to give this a 9 out of 10 gazebos.
Ooh.
Yeah.
9 out of 10 gazebos. Mm-hmm. I'm giving it 10 out of 10 Julie Andrews.
Very nice. You said that with a very challenging look in your eye. Like, Piper, I like this more than you.
I like this more than you. And I like it more than everyone. And Julie Andrews deserves everything. I'm all riled up from my fight with the Academy. And then the Tonys shortly after, because they need to give her that Lifetime Achievement Award. Guys, Julie Andrews, as far as I understand it, is in great health. But she is 86 years old.
So we need to honor her while she's around. Also, the Academy and all of your however many hundred members, please meet Lillian at the abandoned Kmart parking lot next week.
Honestly, I'll fight as many people as you can get to show up. I'll fight you all at once.
Amazing. Amazing. I'll be right there beside you, Lillian. I'll help you. 2 against 500. We can do it.
Yay. Oh, okay. Great. Just a fun fact. I usually write down our ratings so I can make little graphics for them. I couldn't think how to spell gazebo, so I drew one.
Cute. Oh, little gazebes. I think I'm not doing 10 out of 10 just because, yeah, it is so long.
It's so long.
The nun stuff, the German stuff, the Nazi stuff, I always kind of tend to zone out when that's happening still. So it's not like the perfect movie. One thing I thought was so funny is so when they're singing at the concert at the very end, they just kept singing about jam and bread. And I was like, why? Why? They're like forever. They're like, tea with jam, jam and bread, bread and tea and tea and jam with bread. And I'm like, we get it. Enough with the tea and the jam and the freaking bread.
They let Gretel pick a song.
Yeah, she's like, I rewrote this one. This is my favorite part. But yeah, otherwise great movie.
Yeah, no, I definitely think it's like a little bit on the long side, but I think some of it was the expectations I came in with. I was like, this is like a middling movie. Because I just got so sick of it. But very, very good. Cool story. Big fan. We're going back to the book. And I know that our most obsessed listeners, we love you guys, are going to be very upset to learn that we've changed our book chunks once again.
The St. John's part is so long, you guys.
It's so long.
And we don't like St. John, so we don't want to have to read through all of this stuff.
Really? Both been avoiding this, and we have to record early this week because Piper's going out of town.
Yeah.
So we are going to read for chunk 6, chapters 28 through 33, and we're going to read through chapter 33. Mm-hmm. And then the next chunk will just be through the end.
Cool.
You say that like you just learned this.
I'm like, rad. Awesome.
So excited. I'm so glad that you're still saying the thing we agreed upon before we started recording.
Well, you could have just like thrown a wild card in here and be like, and actually we're finishing the book. Ha ha, Piper, suck it. And be like, no.
Piper, we're putting this on the internet and you're now, hell do it. No, but I'll update the website by the time you guys are listening to me say this now. Just another adjustment because I don't want to read about him. And I'm genuinely certain that it's better than it is in any of the adaptions because we get to be in Jane's head, and I'm sure what Jane's thinking is more interesting than anything St. John has ever said.
Yeah. Take that man who we haven't even met in the book yet, but we already know we don't like him.
If you want to tell us why you like St. John, you can find us on all the social medias at Airbuds. We're on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And then you can also email us at airbuds@gmail.com.
Absolutely. And if you like listening to us ramble about old movies that we love and new movies that we haven't seen yet, then please leave us a 5-star review with a nice comment or two and share it with your friends and join us in this rambling adventure.
New movies that we haven't seen.
Yeah, you know, I'm hypothesizing for the stuff that's coming down the road that we will ramble about.
I don't know why that was so funny to me. I think it's because we've been talking for 3 years and we're never going to let our listeners go.
Except we will let them go right now. Bye, guys. We have a lot of reading to do, and maybe if you're reading along with us, you do too. So good luck with that. Happy Jane Eyre reading and watching. Wish us luck. I'll need it.
Bye.
Bye.